Oh, so thank you, Colonel Prasad. Now I would like to call upon stage Dr. Srinivas Kandula, CEO Capgemini India. He is an indeed, you know, very celebrated person with over 25 years of rich experience in business management and strategy. I'm sure that you would think that your students would reach up to such a level one day. Dr. Srinivas Rao Kandula serves as head of India at Capgemini Australia Limited. Dr. Kandula has been chief executive CEO of India operations at Capgemini since January 1st, 2016. Dr. Kandula has a doctorate degree in strategic human resource management from XLRI School of Business and Human Resources and a master's of human resource management from Andhra University. He's a preferred speaker at HR forums in NASCOM, CII, National HRD Network, and lectures on special invitation at XLRI, MDI, ASCI, and IIMs. Dr. Kandula, would love to have you on stage. May we have a round of applause for Dr. Kandula, please. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Distinguished teachers, administrators, and award winners. It is indeed very paradox because I'm not sure what qualifies me to speak in this conference. Other than that, I'm a good friend of K.V. Brahmam. Nevertheless, I made some effort to share my views because though I'm not quite familiar with the input of the education processes, but I am the recipient of output of your efforts. That Capgemini has recruited over 1 lakh people in the last 15 years because we started our operations about 15 years back in India with 10 employees. Now we are at, I think, 1,234,000 or so as I'm speaking to you. I'm the one who strongly believes that education system is far more important than anything else. My job takes me to travel across, and when I question myself, what actually that distinguishes the developed nations from that of a country like India? And often it comes across to me, it is simply their education system. And we have, with all apologies, I may be a little bit critical, but you have to tolerate that with me. And most part of my student life, I have been very, very bad student. And so therefore, I claim I am product of some good teachers who have not taught me when I was at school. Have they really taught me? Have I really learned that? I am not sure what I would have been doing in my life. Because of the strong education system in countries like United States or certain European countries, they are able to achieve what it is today. I'll share with you some statistics. I do not know who is handling my slides. That we have over 500 million workforce in India today. And out of that, let me tell you, hardly about 40 million of them are really skilled to do the job they have undertaken. On the top of it, every year we have been adding 12 million more people to the workforce. That is about 1 million people every month, about 10 lakh people. Though not many people says that employment is an issue, but that is not an issue. As one of our lifetime award achievement winners said that rightly, the employability has been the issue. As I said, we recruit and we have to train them again afresh. We actually recruit from almost premier engineering schools in this country. When we recruit them again, we have to put massive effort to train them and employable in our own company. That has been the big tragedy. The reason is, even when I was studying, we were not prepared to work in professions those exist today. I don't think about 25, 30 years back anyone was trained on software programming or the skills required for the IT industry. But today, industries like telecommunications, IT and are very, very dominant. So therefore, always the education system in India has been much behind comparing to what the society actually requires. On the top of it, we have in our country, you know, the biggest bane is the academic inflation. That what is generally known as the Flynn effect. That Flynn, James Flynn, a political sociologist in New Zealand, have found that the intelligent quotient scores have been going up steadily year after year. In fact, most of the people today, when you give them an IQ test, they perform much better, about 61 times better than comparing to the people about 40 years back. But when you look at the original research, or in terms of patents, in terms of IPs, it has not grown proportionately. What actually has gone up is the techniques, like some of the products that they have demonstrated today I have seen. But not the real wisdom, not the real knowledge. I used to go to a government school when I was in my primary education. I think if I remember well, we were a class of about 50 students roughly in our 10th standard. 2-3 students used to get first class, and about 10 students used to get second class. About 15 to 20 of them pass in third division. Half of the class used to fail. In fact, I failed once in my 10th standard. My brothers have failed twice and thrice, therefore I am considered to be smartest guy in my home. It's a different thing. If I go to the same school now, out of the 50 students if I take, 49 are distinctions. And one is the first class. And if you see the number of engineering schools, those have come up between Chennai and Bangalore if you are driving. I'm not sure what they are going to do with them, either they have to convert them into cyclone shelters or wedding halls. Research. So one is we have inflated our academic system that trying to label everyone that you have done well. I am not able to understand the 100 out of 100 of it is possible. Even if you are doing the same thing repeatedly, like Dhoni has done in cricket, if you want him to play now, he can't get 100 out of 100. One is that we have completely mismanaged both the educational imparting part of it as well as the assessment part of it. So therefore we are in a situation, we don't know what we know. Otherwise, a country of billion people with millions of education institutions not able to generate a worth IP, a worth patent that can be monetized. A company like Apple, Google, Facebook, their revenues put together are equivalent to government of India budget. Three companies do the economy generate equivalent to a billion people. It is not because of a bad economic policy. It is not something like a GST. It is because of the bad education system which we have in the country. That we have not updated, and we don't teach to the children what actually is required for them, because we do take, my average age of my workforce in India is 27 years. On the top of it, we have a situation, the new generation, unlike when I was studying in a small town, in our mind it was very clear, the rich people are always rich, middle class are always middle, poor people are poor. There was no any such big grudge. Hardly in that small town used to be one Dakota ambassador and three Chetak scooters. So therefore you don't have any grudge. But today the younger people are not going to accept it. If you see on a road a BMW car, you wanted to have one. And children will ask, what I need to do? You need to do a good job or you need to achieve something? Yes, I will do. But where is the opportunity? And opportunity someone is not going to create. Everyone has to create their own opportunity for which the education has to play a dominant role. So therefore, it has to prepare people for the leadership. It has to prepare for the people for innovation and creativity. Unfortunately, we have created an education system. If you go to a developed country, basically that they classify students into two. One is the students who have an innovation capability, a creative capability, that they are going to innovate something. So therefore, for them, the education system is played very, very rigorously. That is what a Stanford stands for, or a MIT stands for. And then you have other set of students that who are meant for execution. They are not going to innovate, they are not going to develop. When something is laid down, they have the discipline and capability to travel in that path meticulously. And we created an education system where everybody is prepared for the middle path. Neither they can innovate nor they can participate in execution. As a result, you struggle to get an electrician, a plumber, a mason, anything, you name it. You don't have. Isn't it? That is what we struggle. If you look at the infrastructure sector in India, which require over 100 million people, there are people, but they are not trained. They are not skilled. And you have an industry that requires textile. You don't have skills. Hospitality, you don't have skills. Even a middle class today would like to go to a Thailand or a Singapore or a Dubai to do vacation rather than going any other place in India. There is something seriously wrong there. So therefore, we created over a period of time an education system that doesn't place any pressure on the individual, either to participate in execution nor in research. Something, that's why I call it as an empty raincoat. Charles Handy says, there used to be a statue in Berlin, in London, in Germany, that you go, that statue, you see that there is a person standing there. Actually, there is no person, there is only an empty raincoat. The whole education system has become a sham, it has become like an empty raincoat. So again, as I said, my apologies for being very critical, but that is the reality that we are facing today. Even the few bright people, whosoever are there, they can't survive here because the whole system engineered and architected to serve this middle path, neither for the researchers nor for the execution members. Because we don't respect an electrician, we don't respect a driver, we don't respect a hospital staff. Therefore, nobody would like to choose those professions. If you go to any country, anywhere else in the world, I am sure that a normal technician is as well respected as a senior cardiologist. And then here we have created that kind of class. Therefore, knowing very well, you would not like your son or your daughter to be a hairstylist because it is a barber's job. And we have to understand most of our children cannot innovate a product like an Apple or they cannot create a search engine like Google. So what are you going to do? And you create an empty raincoat, sending them to the engineering schools, sending them to the management schools and awarding them with a degree like some of us had stalls today. So what are you going to create out of that? And you are going to create a significant civil strife in Indian society. People are not going to tolerate like earlier generations have tolerated. They want good facilities. They want good life. All information is accessible to them. They know how else the people are living. How they are living. So they are not going to accept. And though a country that of a billion people has enormous opportunities to upgrade their lifestyle, their life standards. You need to create millions of hospitals. You need to create millions of kilometers of road infrastructure. You need to create an entertainment industry. You need to create a technology industry, a textile industry, a biotech industry. And I am afraid that by the time that we are actually engineered, and then with the machine learning and AI, with the new technology, you will have robots, which would have been prepared much better, that execution workforce, rather than the people whom we have. So therefore, my view is that because of a failed education system, India is going to be a classic case how a revolution will take place in a society of 350 young people with 25 years of average age. And you actually that need to build leadership in some people, not in everybody else. You just need about 5% of the leadership skills and 95% of the people as a part of execution. So what I wanted to conclude, we are not good in any of these places. So therefore, we are going to pay heavy price for it. And if we wanted to address that, I thought that we will address the education system and education policy much more seriously than any other government. So I am quite hopeful that may come, and unless that is there, trust me that it is an empyrean quote. So thank you very much for your time and for your audience and attention that before the lunch. Thank you very much. So there are some slides which I prepared. It is full of numbers and then statistics. If it is useful to some of you can look at, I would request the administrators that share with all of you. Thank you very much.
Do you have some questions for Dr. Kandula? Does anybody have any question? Okay, so thank you, Dr. Kandula. Your talk was immensely beneficial, at least for the ones who have been hearing words such as unemployability, demographic disaster, jobs going away. I think Bangalore was in the news or have been in the news after the IT jobs have been laid down. There have been a lot of laying down of IT jobs. I think this is, you have touched upon some of the most important points. So going on to the next section of the event, we want to start off with the award ceremony. For the most innovation, for the most innovative awards for Bangalore. To felicitate the awardees, may I call upon stage Dr. Kandula? Dr. Kandula? Thank you, Dr. Kandula. So the first award is in the category of Best Uniform Manufacturers of the Year. And the award goes to Harsh and Harry Uniforms. May I please call upon Kaja Mehdeen to receive the award on behalf of Harsh and Harry Uniforms. May I please hear a round of applause from the audience? Thank you. Can I get Kaja Mehdeen from Harsh and Harry Uniforms to receive the award? Okay, so we are going to go to the next one of Best Educational Hardware of the Year. Okay, so Kaja Mehdeen, can we please have you on stage? Thank you. Our next award goes to Best Educational Hardware of the Year to My Talking Tree. May I call upon Mr. Hari Babu to receive the award? Mr. Hari Babu, can we have you on the stage to receive the award for Best Educational Hardware of the Year? May I please request Dr. Kandula to felicitate. And I know you must be really, really hungry, especially without a tea break, but would love to have you give a round of applause to the awardees. Thank you. The next award for Best ERP Solution of the Year goes to NTAP Infotech. May I please call upon Vineet Thomas to receive the award. Vineet Thomas from Entab Infotech for Best ERP Solution of the Year. Thank you. Yes, that's good. I really like the applause now. Okay, so the Best Language Lab of the Year goes to Wordsworth English Language Lab to Mr. Jaswinder Singh. Can we please call upon Jaswinder Singh ji to our on stage? Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kandula. Thank you, Mr. Hari. Thank you, Dr. Kandula. May I please call upon Mr. Arunab Singh to come on stage to award the other innovative awards. Thank you, Arunab. Mr. Arunab Singh is the CEO of Nehru International School in Ghaziabad. May I please call upon stage for the Best Innovation in Early Childhood Education of the Year to Your Baby Can. May I please call upon stage Mr. Girish Nagpal. Girish Nagpal to receive the award. Mr. Girish Nagpal from your Baby Can as the Best Innovation in Early Childhood Education of the Year. Can we have a huge round of applause for Your Baby Can? Of course, Your Baby Can. The next award goes to Best E-Learning Company of the Year. It goes to iScholar Education Services. May I call upon stage Colonel Rajendra Prasad to receive the award.